fine.
Singing, yes, Jesus.
don't mind. That's why we're here, so you guys can sing and have a good time. Jesus loves me, he who died. Heaven's gates to open wide. He will wash away my sin. Let his little child come in. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes. Jesus loves me still. Though I'm very weak and ill, from his shining throne on high comes to watch me where I lie. Singing, yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me, for the Bible tells me so.
Leave your Bible be flat.
Jesus loves me, he will stay close beside me all the way. If I love him when I die, yes, Jesus loves me, for the Bible tells me so.
Amen. Got any requests? No. How's everybody doing today? Everybody okay? Okay. You okay, sir? Amen. I had prayer a while ago, but any time any of you guys want special prayer requests, we've had a prayer list. We put people's names on at the church. The whole nursing home here and rest home rehab is on the prayer list, but I like to put individual names if you have something specific, God knows about it. And we can put your name down. You don't have to tell us anything specific, just your name. And God, I believe he can move upon that. You know, if we have faith as a grain of mustard seed, as small as a mustard seed, it, you know, it can move mountains. You know, if we just trust him and put our faith in him. And I know he can do many things. I'll fly away. Is that the one you want to do?
That's the one.
Is that the one you did on that page?
Yeah.
Okay.
Some glad morning when his life is over, I fly away to a home on God's celestial shore.
Grown. guys want to help us, come on, help us. Amen. We like all the help we can get. I'll let you take it.
Just a few more weary days and then
was free.
good thing. Now I gladly own him as my king. Now my rapture's token only sing of Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burden sold my liberty.
Well, it's cold.
cold outside. It is really cold outside. You're not recording yet, sir.
Yes.
That's all right. We can take out any parts that we don't want.
Oh, okay.
Bad thing is we want it all.
I agree.
Even all the mistakes. I'm going to try to sing this one.
Thank you.
give Mr. Hamm a hand.
I'll give you a hand.
Yeah, let's give the Lord a hand. God is good, you know that, all the time. And he does so much for his children and for those who's willing to put him first in their life. God wants to bless his children, and he's wanting to do something special for each and every one of them. And I believe God has something special for you guys here too. If we're willing to put him first in our life and allow him to be Lord, that means L-O-R-D, that charge, in charge of our lives. And he, you know what?
I heard you.
He's leading the way. It's always there. And he's leading the way. It's always a truer path. And there's nothing more sure than the way the Lord has us to go. Chastity, you want to sing that song now?
Which one?
The one you had up earlier, and I said, do it later. That being the cause.
Oh.
Chastity has a special song today for you guys, and we'll try to sing it together. But don't you want to lead it, and then I'm going to help you. You just, I'll do it in your key.
No more.
fussing at you saying what?
She keeps fussing at me saying, we need to practice, we need to practice. And I keep putting it off because the only thing I'm going to do is just read the word and stuff. And she's right, we do need to practice. And got to honor that. And, you know, sometimes I had to listen to my wife. I had to heed what she says because she's got some good advice a lot of times. And sometimes I get a little ornery and don't want to listen. And I apologize for today because we messed up with quite a bit because of bad eyesight for one thing. The main reason, I don't want to blame it on bad eyes, is this ain't been practicing like we should.
I just blame it on me.
No, I can't blame it on you. You use a mighty fine help, and I appreciate all the help you give, Mr. Hammond. Thank you very much. Before we go do anything, I want to read a little few verses of scripture to you today out of the Bible. And I just want to cover a few things real quick, if that's all right. And you can take this home with you or back to your room and study it out if you want to later on. And, you know, everything that I say, I want you to be like the Berean. And those that know the Berean, or those that never took the Apostle Paul at his word, everything that was said to them, that, or anybody said to them, they went to study the scriptures to see whether those things were true. And that's how we all should be. We all should be like the Berean, always seeking God, whether something or not is true being taught to us. And the only thing I ever desire is to speak the truth. And I'm going to pray now. Heavenly Father, thank you, God, for allowing us to be here today, God. And I pray for each and every mind and each and every person in this place. God, help those that you have this message for just be receptive, God. And Lord, I pray, Father, that you bind Satan, God, hedge this place about, God, and just put a watchman behind my mouth, God. And I just want to say everything pleasing to you and everything to the edifying of your body and your church, God, and everything be done for your kingdom and your glory. Father, I just want to pray right now that you'd hide me behind the cross. I don't want to do nothing outside of your perfect will and your perfect way. Everything, God, in Jesus Christ's holy name. Amen.
Amen.
I'm going to read out of 1 Corinthians right now, and the message is beginning. It seems like every time we come, we do the singing, and then we read a few verses of Scripture, and last couple of times it's been all right, but beforehand it was like message after message after. I know it's not intentional, it's just, that's just how it happens sometimes. And, you know, people had things to say that couldn't seem to wait. And, you know, we're going to pray that God had his way here today. And I'm going to read out 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 26 through 31. And the thought that I want to leave with you is, because he lives. Is because he lives. That song we just sung, that's what I want to talk to you a little bit about. Why we have what we have is because he lives. And I want to read out of 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 26 through 31. And it says, I'll get a foothold, and what that means, I'm going to read a couple of verses ahead of that so we know a little bit about what's being talked about. And verse 24, but unto them which are called both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God, because the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. 26, for ye see your calling, brethren, how that not many wise men, not many noble are called, but God hath chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise, and God hath chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty, and base things of the world, and the things which are despised hath God chosen, yea, and things which are not to bring to naught things that are, that no flesh should glory in his presence, but of him Are ye in Christ Jesus, who of God is made unto us wisdom and righteousness and sanctification and redemption, that according as it is written, he that glorieth, let him glory in the Lord. God, add your richest blessing on the reading. Now I want to give you a little introduction today to what I just read. And it says, there's an elevated railway used to make called stops at Calvary Cemetery, called station. All other stops were automatic, but to stop at Calvary demands a clear desire and signal. The train of life stops at many places without a signal also, but to stop at Calvary takes a clear choice and signal. You know, Jesus stopped there, may look wrong, may look like a wrong choice, because that's where the Lord Jesus Christ hung on the cross. He says, but 3 days later, he showed that it was not the wrong stop. The resurrection makes all of life different. Each one of us has to make that decision, if we've not already, to stop at Calvary. And I want to talk to you about what it gives us. Because he lives, I can face life. I don't have to worry. In Matthew 26, 6, 26 through 34. And I'm going to read that to you real quick. I got a little thing here that bring me to the scripture real quick. And it says, behold, and we'll get a footnote right there. If you ever want to bring your Bibles, Bibles are welcome. We enjoy the Word of God and to have His Word. And, you know, I love God's Word. And if you want to bring your Bible and follow along anytime, it's more than welcome. This thing is acting up a little bit, but that's all right. We'll turn to Matthew. There it is. And it says, therefore I say unto you, take no thought for your life, what ye shall eat or what ye shall drink, nor yet for your body what ye shall put on. It is not life more than meat, and body more than raiment? Behold, the fowls of the air, for they sow not, neither do they reap, nor gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feedeth them. Are ye not much more than they? Which of you, do taking thought, can add one cubit unto his stature? And why take ye thought for raiment? Consider the lilies of the field, for how they grow. They toil not, neither do they spin. These are all the words of the Lord Jesus Christ, the words in red. And yet I say unto you, that even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Wherefore, if God so clothe the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow is cast into the oven, shall he not much more clothe you, O ye of little faith? Therefore, take no thought, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink? Wherewith shall we be clothed? For after all these things do the Gentiles seek. For your heavenly Father knoweth that what ye have need of all these things. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Take therefore no thought for tomorrow, for the morrow shall take thought for the things of itself. Sufficient is a day of the evil thereof. Because he lives, I can face life. And simply, you know, he supplies everything that we need. We don't have to worry about our clothing or our next meal. God's got it all under control. It's simply what he's saying there. And we need to believe that he is able to do that which he promised. Do you believe God is true? That he cannot lie? Who believes God cannot lie? I believe God cannot lie. He's a truth speaker. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. He is truth. That is one of his names. And there's no lie in him. Everything he speaks is truth, and it's something we can put our faith and trust in, is on his word. Who knows that the Bible, that this is the living word of God, the spoken, inspired word of God, is something you can stand and trust on. You know, God has spoken it, it's forever settled, and we just need to believe him sometime that he's able to supply all our needs according to his riches and glory. And he's richer than any king. God's richer than all things. You know why? Because he owns all things. He owns all the hills. He owns all the mountains. He owns the earth. He owns the heavens. He owns the stars and the heavens. And you don't think that he can take care of each and every one of your desires and every one of your thoughts? So what he's saying is, don't sit there and worry about things that you can't control. Let him control it. He wants to be Lord of your life. Let him be Lord of your life. And if you just trust him, because he lives, you can face life. He rose from that grave at Calvary. He went to Calvary and rose so you can have life in it more abundantly. He took care of death. He became victorious over death, hell, and the grave there on Calvary. Who knows that? Do you know that Jesus took care of all things right there on Calvary? He died on the cross for your sins, rose the third day for you, so you could be redeemed, could rise with him. Amen. Who knows that? If you don't, then it's something I got to tell you. We have a risen Savior, and he's the Lord Jesus Christ, and he died for each and every one of you. And it says, if we'll just trust him, God shall supply all our needs according to his riches and glory. Whatever life's tragedy, Christ can give courage and victory. You know, me and my wife, we went through many things in our life. Not too long ago, they said that I was going to... Why fusses at me when I take the oxygen off? But sometimes I do, and if I'm gonna drag it with me, so she don't get mad at me. Okay, I do get a little weak when I take it off, and cause my oxygen level gets low. But you know, there's things that me and my wife go through all the time, and us as Christians, you know, this we didn't tell no one. We had lack of food in our home. And that ain't something we would ever tell anybody. And we knew that God could take care of it. And, you know, it's something we don't really worry about. But we was asking God, said, God, you know, you see the lack here. You said that you'd take care of this need. And you know what happened? Tell them what happened today. Give a testimony of what happened today.
His mother come by and brought like 5 bags of groceries.
And we didn't have to ask. It ain't nothing we need grocery. We never ask for that. It's something that God laid it on somebody's heart. That person was willing to listen and bring those groceries up. You know, sometimes God will lay something on a Christian's heart, and if that Christian doesn't listen, then somebody out there is doing without. Not because of God's not able, because of one person's disobedience. I preached the other day on heeding the call on the road to Damascus. Did I not, Jess? And on the road to Damascus, there was a call come to a guy named Saul. And this guy he was one of the guys who persecuted the church, and he was out to kill any Christian or any person that brought up the name of Jesus. And it was his job, and he believed with all of his heart that he was doing the will of God. He believed in every sense of his being that he was following God's perfect will. He was sent by the synagogue, the high priest. He had the papers on the road to Damascus to collect all the Damascus Christians and bring them back to Jerusalem to be tried and killed. He stood there at the very feet of Stephen when he was being stoned, and I'll read that later on. So there's a guy that persecuted the church on the road to Damascus. Jesus showed up and said, "Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me?" He falls down on his knees before a holy and righteous God. That's just something that happens. Every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess. When Jesus shows up on the scene, nobody will be able to stand. No person. I won't be able to. Nobody. We're all going to end up on our faces before a holy and righteous God. And when he showed up, Saul, a persecutor of the church, falls on his face before Jesus, the one that he's persecuting. He said, "Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me?" He was attacking the church, and when you attack the church, you're attacking the Lord Jesus Christ himself. He is the head, and the church is the body. And when you attack the church, you're attacking the body of Christ. He said, "Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me?" He said, "Lord, who art thou? And what must I do?" He said, "I am Jesus whom thou persecutest." And he told him, "Arise." Saul didn't have to arise then. But Jesus told him to arise and go to Damascus and there, and he'll tell him what to do. So he stood up and he arose, and they had to lead him to Damascus. You know why? He was blind from the glory of the Lord, from Jesus showing up. No one else there saw that glory, but Jesus was there to say, "That man saw." Other people heard a rumbling and a sound. He heard the words of the Lord Jesus Christ. And he told him, "Arise and go to Damascus, and I'll tell you what to do when you get there." He didn't say he'd tell him immediately. He told him, he said, "When you get there, I'll tell you." But you know what? Saul got up, and they led him to Damascus. And he heeded a call there. That was the first step. He listened to the Lord, he got up and followed. And then he went to Damascus, and you know what he did? He was trembling when he fell before the Lord. He was fearful, and he was shaking and trembling. So he had a fear for God. He knew that was the Lord Jesus Christ, and that was God there at that point. So he goes back to Damascus, and this man, Saul, he fasted for 3 days. He didn't even touch bread or water. He was blind, he couldn't see, and all thing he was thinking of was what the Lord Jesus Christ told him. He said, "Arise, go to Damascus, and I will show you what you shall do." And as he was fasting and praying, and when you seek God, God will answer. It might not be the answer we want, but he will answer. And he answered Saul and showed him in a vision that there would be a man named Ananias who would show up and lay hands on him, and he would receive his sight and tell him what he should do. And at the same time, there was a holy man of God who had a good testimony on the other side of town. And the Lord Jesus Christ showed up. You know what he did? He fell on his face. You know why? Because you fall on your face before a holy and righteous God when he shows up. And he fell on his face. And he said, "Lord, what do you want? And what would you have me to do?" He said, "There's this man named Saul. And I want you to go to the road named Straight." He gave him specific directions. You know, the Lord does that. So he didn't have no way out. He told him exactly where to go. exactly what to do. I want you to go this road name straight to this house where this one particular, he names the guy, and he says, I want you to lay your hands on him that he receive his sight and tell him I have chosen him for my purpose and my name. And Ananias said, oh, Lord, wait, I've heard things about this man. This man has persecuted the church. He got the papers and has come on his way right now to kill and bind those Christians that are in Damascus. But he said, no, no. He said, I have chosen him to bring my name before the Gentiles and kings. And Saul, right then at that, Ananias at that point, he said, he got up and went and laid hands on Saul. And it was like flakes or like a covering fell from his eyes and he received his sight. He told him that he must suffer many things for Jesus Christ's name. But you know what? That didn't stop him. He wanted Jesus to be first in his life. And he let the Lord Jesus Christ be Lord of his life. And because of that, God ends up using him to write over two-thirds, close to two-thirds of the New Testament, our Bible today. God used that man and ends up giving him a new name, a name called Apostle Paul. Who knows Apostle Paul? His name was Saul, and he was a persecutor of the church, and then he became the one who was sent to the Gentiles. You know who we are? We're Gentiles. And because Apostle Paul was obedient to the Lord Jesus Christ, a lot of us are here today and able to say, thank you, Lord Jesus, for saving me. Thank you for that faithful one that give that choice, that made that choice to follow you. You know, when I was 16, I want to thank God for a man who was faithful and made a choice to follow Jesus because, you know, when I was earlier, when I was young, around the age of 8, I went to church, and I'm named the church, but I was raised in a Southern Baptist church, and I went to altar at an early age because the pastor or a preacher there told me, he said, if you don't want to go to hell, you need to come to the altar. Well, I was a young kid, and of course I did not want to go to hell. No child or any person in their right mind would. And I was baptized, and I thought I was saved. Don't base your salvation on what any man has ever said. It's on what the Lord Jesus Christ has done. And when at the age of 16, at 15, I started taking lessons from this one guy that had learned in guitar, and he was a preacher. And he started praying, and he started talking about the Lord around me, and he started witnessing to me. And one day, you know what happened? The Lord Jesus Christ showed up. The Holy Ghost, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Ghost. God the Holy Ghost shows up. And you know what happens? I fall to my knees. No one had to tell me to fall to my knees. I fell to my knees, trembling, and said, there was two preachers in the room at that time, and they were just talking to each other. And they looked at each other and said, God's here to save someone. And I said, yes, he's here to save me. And right then, you know what? I admitted I needed a Savior. I accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as my Savior right then and there. That's when I got saved. And I want to thank God because of one person's obedience back then, I'm here today. And you know, sometimes God allows things that happen to certain people to be a light. And they sent me home to die a couple years ago. And by His grace and His glory, I'm still here today. And He has a purpose for each and every one of us, if we're willing to let Him be first. That was the first point.
And I also want to read out of Romans 8:28. And I was flipped there because phone won't seem to ever work, right? So technology, I don't mind it. When it doesn't work. Like when it does. 8:28, and I'll just read it to you real quick and tell you what the verse says. And it says, and we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called according to his purpose. Everything I went through, everything that happened was according to his purpose. And all things work together for good to them who love the Lord. Amen. Amen. Because he lives, I can face death. You know, there was a very real sentence of death over my life, was it not, Jack?
Yeah.
And they were saying, you know, I wasn't going to maybe live through a year. They didn't, the doctors really didn't see how it was possible. But because he lives, I could face death. And, you know, we have a testimony of people. I have a book at the house called The Dying Testimony of the Lost and Saved. And there's a lot of people, you know, that you read about before they, back in older times, before they started using all the drugs and stuff to take away people's pain, you'd actually see the difference between a lost person dying and a saved person dying. And I'll read you two incidents out of the Bible, not the book, that I have at the house, but actually out of the Bible. And I talked about it earlier, about Stephen being stoned and dying. And I want you to hear his testimony when he died. This is Stephen's testimony in Acts 7, 56 through 60. And I'll read it to you really quick. And Stephen was a young deacon in the early church, and he was on fire for God. And he had a desire to preach God's word and serve God anywhere and everywhere that God would see fit to use him. And here at his death, he was witnessing and talking to the synagogue and being a faithful to that call and being heeding to what Jesus Christ would have him do. And it says, and they heard these things. They were cut to the heart. Holy Ghost conviction struck them in the heart because the truth does that. It said the word of God is as a sword, and it cuts to and fro. The Spirit of God is, it cuts to and fro, cuts going in, cuts going out. And it says that they heard these things. They were cut to the heart, and they gnashed on him with their teeth. But he, being full of the Holy Ghost, looked up steadfastly into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing on the right hand of God, and said, behold, I see the heavens open and the Son of Man standing on the right hand of God. And and they cried with one voice, a loud voice, and stopped their ears because they didn't want to hear his dying testimony, and ran upon him with one accord and cast him out of the city and stoned him in the wilderness and laid down their clothes at the young man's feet, whose name was Saul. So they laid their clothes down at this young man named Saul, the one that was persecuting the church. He was there at the witnessing Stephen being stoned to death, a young deacon in the church. And they stoned Stephen, calling upon God and saying, this is what Stephen is saying. He's saying, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. And he kneeled down and cried with a loud voice, Lord, lay not this sin to their charge. Don't put this on their account. Don't blame them for what they're doing. They're ignorant. They don't know no better. They're lost. They don't know right from wrong yet because they're lost. He said, lay this sin not to their charge. And when he had said this, he fell asleep. He died. He gave up the ghost. He died. That was Stephen's testimony. Apostle Paul's testimony after years of witnessing and going through many trials and being beaten and whipped and going through many things, this was his testimony. I ran a good fight, I fought a good faith. And I'll just read it. 7 and 8. God's word said it would not come back void, and I want his word out there. I want y'all to hear the word of God. Running a little long. I'm about finished, guys. Just give me one more second and I will be finished. 2 Timothy 4:7-8. And it says, and I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give at that day, and not to me only, but unto all them also love is appearing. You know, there was a testimony right there of two men who fought a fight, who stood up for Jesus. And because he lives, they can face death. And you know what? Jesus provided a way. And because he lives, I'm going to hit one last point and I'm closing. It says, because he lives, I can face eternity. Judgment is a very real thing. In Hebrews 9:27, I'll read it to you. Just give me 1 second. I'm right here at it. I had all these marked out earlier, and thing is not wanting to cooperate, but 9:27 says, and as it is appointed unto men once to die, and after this, the judgment. You know, every one of us one day is going to have to face the judgment seat. And it says, and many want to do away with the talk of hell and certain judgment, but it can't be done away with. Often the same verse that talks about eternal life and speaks of hell and death, like Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of it. I'll just read it to you just to be sure I get the right verse. There it is. 6:23, I think that was 3:20. There it is. 6:23, 26. And it says, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift, yeah, that's right. And the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. We have a true gift, and it is only through the Lord Jesus. Everybody knows the verse, most people do, John 3:16. Most people hear it all the time. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. We can face eternity because he lives. And why did Christ go to the cross? If everyone will be saved, he went because only those who accept Jesus as their Lord will be saved. He is the only way into heaven. Only way. No man. Acts 4:12, neither is there salvation in any other. For there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. And he said, Jesus said unto them, I am the way, the truth, and life. No man come to the Father but by me. He's the only way. He is the door to the sheepfold. And no one comes into the sheepfold, but only one way. anybody tries to get in any other way, the same as a thief and a robber. Jesus Christ is the only way into heaven. And because he lives, I can face eternity. Can you face life? Are your problems too hard to handle? Are pills or whatever, I don't know what it might be in your life. Anything that might be hindering you for turning over your life to Christ, we just need to accept him today. And you know what? Jesus Christ is willing to do something special for each and every one of you. I'm going to play a song real quick and sing a stanza. And just give you an opportunity, if you want to, then we're going to close. Thy mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in thine heart God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. And the Lord Jesus Christ knows your heart and knows your soul and knows what you're going through.
Just as I
For it's in Jesus Christ's holy name we do pray. Amen.
Amen.